There are growing concerns over the spread of COVID at schools in Sydney's east. Almost half the children at Bondi Public School have been forced to isolate after a positive case on Saturday. New South Wales recorded 262 new infections out of more than 80,000 tests, and three more people have died. Let's have a look at the vaccination tracking. Nearly 95% of eligible adults in New South Wales have had one shot. 91.5% are fully vaccinated. Almost 75% of children aged between 12 and 15 are double jabbed. Jobs and wages have been front and centre today, with the Prime Minister taking his pre-election roadshow to a Sydney brewery to talk about Australia's economic recovery. We'll go live to our federal political reporter Fiona Willenfee. Good afternoon. Scott Morrison claims there'll soon be a surge in employment.
Davina, the Prime Minister says more than 280,000 jobs will be created by Christmas. So this is based on data from the Bureau of Statistics after previous lockdowns, and the PM's office has been crunching the numbers and come up with these predictions. But something to keep in mind here, more than 330,000 jobs were lost between August and October due to COVID restrictions. So even if this forecast is correct, it appears not all of those will be returned.
There are thousands and thousands and thousands of jobs which employers around the country are now looking to fill as the recovery takes hold.
Once again, the Prime Minister's trying to take credit for jobs which haven't materialised.
While the government wanted to talk about jobs today, Labor wanted to focus the economic argument on wages and the cost of living, saying petrol prices are going up while wages are going nowhere.
The government's own projections are that real wages will decline over the next 4 years. This is a government that don't have a plan for secure work, don't have a plan to lift real wages.
New figures show wages have climbed more than 2% over the past year to September. The Reserve Bank doesn't believe they'll rise rapidly. Davina?
OK, Fee, thank you. Well, the New South Wales Premier has visited the flood-affected town of Forbes in the state's central west, where he's been grilled over strategies to keep the town safe. Hayley Francis is there.
Well, we're at one of hundreds of properties in the Lachlan Valley that are set to lose millions of dollars in crop losses from this flood event. The Premier, with his Deputy and Minister for Emergency Services, David Elliott, by his side, chopped it in this morning, first thanking the 300 SES volunteers who have been on the ground here for a week and have helped save those properties. Now, more than 30,000 sandbags have been filled in the last 48 hours alone, and it's a good thing with the swollen Lachlan River system joining up with the town's lake overnight. That has seen floodwaters go into some more homes. The Premier was grilled over the Wyangala Dam and why case studies into it being raised have taken so long. This is the dam at capacity that has forced huge water releases resulting in that flood event.
The time to respond to those matters are not necessarily in the time of crisis. It's generally in the good times where governments need to actually be making the effort and having the forethought going forward.
The Mayor of Forbes also took advantage of the VIP visit, calling for more government support.
I know you can't have SES headquarters everywhere, but we certainly need a bigger and better one in Forbes.
Now, as I say, flooding has got worse in parts of Forbes today. Here in Bajirabong, these river levels are expected to rise in the coming days, especially with more rain forecast.
Europe is facing a fourth wave of COVID as continents head into winter, and the fallout is going to affect us here in Australia. And for more on this, we're joined in the studio by Charles Crouch. So Charles, take us through the numbers coming out of some of these countries, because they're quite remarkable.
Yeah, really remarkable. Of the 3.3 million cases worldwide last week, more than 2 million, so almost two-thirds, were in continental Europe. And that's being really driven by huge numbers in Germany and Russia. In Germany, they had their highest daily caseload of the entire pandemic yesterday. Russia had their deadliest day of the pandemic yesterday. And this is now spreading into a lot of the Eastern European states. There's some big numbers still in the UK, but the restrictions are really being focused on continental Europe. You know, Austria has locked down for the unvaccinated, and that's causing quite a stir there. The Belgian Prime Minister said that all the alarm signals are red and Europe's map is quickly turning red. There are lockdowns in Sweden. The Czech Republic is refusing some public services to the unvaccinated. Slovakia, the Slovak Republic, is also looking at something pretty similar. There are fears of what was being called a fifth wave in France. Wow. You know, it's just right across the board. And this is all heading into, but not yet in, winter, which is a time in the last few years that Europe has really struggled. You know, people are indoors a lot there, obviously much colder, much darker, much more chance. All of that is all, you know, something that's going to happen over the next few weeks. The epidemiologists and the infectious disease experts are predicting. And there is the potential for this to be a little hint or a sign of what could come in Australia when our winter finally comes next year.
In all likelihood, Australia would experience a honeymoon through the summer period, and then coming out of it was going to be the danger period, because that's exactly what we've seen in Europe.
OK, the added layer into all this for us is that our borders are about to open. So where do we sit in all that?
And in some cases have opened to people coming back from those areas. Look, the big benefit that we have in Australia is vaccination rates at the moment. You know, Europe on a whole is less vaccinated than Australia. There are some countries like Portugal. You know, we know the UK has been very successful that are driving up that vaccine rate. But as a continent, still sit 15% lower than we do in Australia, and that's taking into account places like WA and Queensland that are still sort of lagging behind when it comes to vaccine rates. So whilst there is a message for Australia, there's plenty of time to prepare. We have prepared through vaccination, and now it's a matter of hoping all that preparation pays off in what's to come the next few weeks.
Okay, Charles, thank you.